Have a seat as we begin the section. Sorry for the late start. And yeah, just grab some food and make yourself comfortable. Thank you. So before we start, I just want to extend my appreciation to some people who have helped in putting this program together. That's the Graduate College and the GSA Board for helping us put this program together. To start with, my name is Jerry John Luto, and I am a PhD nursing student in the College of Nursing and Health Profession. And I'm also the Vice President for Academics for the Graduate Student Association. The name is Book and Bagels, and people were expecting bagels to eat, but sorry, we have Mexican food, which I think is better than bagels. All right, so I'm happy you are making yourself comfortable, you are enjoying the meal. So Book and Bagels started some years back, and it's a way actually for graduate students to communicate their research to the university community. And we think this is the best way to help our graduate students begin communicating or actually sending their information across to the general community. So we are happy to have two people today presenting. And before even we start the presentation, I have two announcements to make. One is, if you are willing to present in our next Book and Bagels, which is scheduled for May 13th, please visit the website and submit your speaker request form to us, and we'll be happy to have you present during our next Book and Bagels. Secondly, as we know, the academic year is coming to a close. And the Graduate Student Association have opened nomination for the various positions. We are encouraging all graduate students to visit the website and submit their nomination. It's a very good way to serve your colleague graduate students. So we encourage all of you to do that. We still have all the positions open. I cannot tell you which one and which one, but I believe when you go to the website, you will see all the positions that are open. So I believe you will do that, and thank you for even doing that, as you plan to do it. Yes, so today we have two interesting presentations, and we have a professor in the Department of Psychology to be our moderator. What we normally do is I'll introduce the moderator for today, and he will go ahead and introduce the speakers. So today we're glad to have Dr. Ivan Foreman, who is a professor and a director of the graduate studies in the Department of Psychology. He is a clinical psychologist, and he's an experienced clinical psychologist. I'm a nurse, so I think I know the work that clinical psychologists do. It's one of the interesting work that I wanted to do when I was in the nursing school. But unfortunately, we did not have a lot of clinical psychology programs in Ghana, so I ended up in a PhD nursing program, but that's also fine. His research interest actually is in evaluation of new acceptance based behavior treatment for obesity and other health problems, and he's a seasoned researcher on this field. We're happy to have him today actually moderate this section. With a hand of applause, shall we invite Dr. Ivan Foreman to introduce the first speaker. Thank you.
So hi everyone, happy to be here and happy to get to introduce these two very accomplished speakers and graduate students here. First we're going to hear from Derek Taylor Parrott, who got his bachelor's at Vassar in physics and mathematics, I think. And he went on to Drexel, where he's pursuing a master's in science, technology, and society. And in the fall, he's going to be starting a PhD program at Cornell University, which is actually my alma mater, so I was excited to hear about that. And that will be in science and technology. So Derek's interested, I think, in alternative energy options, especially fusion. He wrote that he's especially interested in how research communities collectively make decisions, and also what are the lasting impacts of those decisions, and how do they justify those decisions to policymakers. So with that, I'm excited to ask him to come up, and he's going to talk about fusion fantasy, the United States' enduring commitment to uncertain energy research.
Hi. As Dr. Furman said, I'm going to be talking about my master's project research, which is looking at how the nuclear fusion research community justifies its continued public support to policymakers, despite these several decades of these huge promises of clean, sustainable, low-conflict energy, but no sort of results as such. So just kind of an overview. Just to kind of give a background for what nuclear fusion promises, nuclear fusion research is primarily geared towards producing a new source of eventually commercializable energy that uses the same sort of physical process that occurs in stars to generate heat, which would then be used to spin turbines and kind of work with the same sort of infrastructure that we have now for energy production and give electricity to the grid. Nuclear fusion is different in that it doesn't require, it wouldn't require the same sorts of safety features as nuclear fission plants that we have in operation now. It has a lot less sort of radioactive waste problems. It's a lot, the fuel is basically adapted from seawater. It's just kind of a very simple process to process salt water from the oceans to use as fuel for these reactors. So it's very appealing in a lot of ways, right? You don't have much of the risks with other things. You don't have the carbon emissions like with a lot of the existing energy options that we have now. And the only problem is that it's very hard to get it to actually happen in laboratory conditions. Without going into too much detail about the like actual physical problems, it's basically just very difficult to, it requires very extreme conditions to get fusion to occur in the lab. Very high pressures, high temperatures, that are very difficult to achieve with the technologies that we have without sort of, it happens kind of, you know, naturally under natural conditions in the sun because of the extreme masses and the gravitational force and the symmetry involved in that system, but that's very hard to reproduce in lab conditions. So significant investment and time and money have gone into researching fusion energy and attempting to bring it to a point where it could be commercialized and actually provide electricity to the grid. this has been going on for since about the 50s now. The first sort of theoretical work on fusion energy happened in the 30s, but it wasn't sort of institutionalized as energy research until the late 40s, early 50s, depending on what you kind of mark as the beginning of that. So this research has been going on for a very long time with no sort of results as such to show. One of the things that's kind of very interesting to me is that this research hasn't been the government hasn't just been supporting existing fusion projects. For example, the National Science Foundation just awarded a career grant to a physicist at the Princeton Plasma Physics Lab, which is one of the U.S.'s biggest and most prominent of the fusion labs. and this, I mean, the whole idea with a career grant is that it's something to kind of promote a researcher's career early on, and it implies an investment in their work throughout the period of their career. So it implies not just investment in existing projects, kind of finishing those off, but it implies an investment in new research kind of going forward. But like I said, none of these projects have kind of produced this big end result that they're promising. there have been these sort of milestones, these periodic, like, we got this higher pressure, we got a higher density, but there aren't these final end results that the promise of which is kind of sustaining the research. there's uncertainty in a lot of different senses here. You've got, both within the physics community, there's uncertainty over whether fusion will actually ever reach a point where it could be commercialized. There's uncertainty about which reactor design or which method is best or even like feasible for this. And then, I mean, you've got doubt from and uncertainty in the sort of political and social spheres as well. You've got, there's a lot of, it's not just a question of when this will happen, it's a question of if this will happen. And that isn't coming just from outside of the research community, right? It's not just, like, popular media skeptics questioning this. It's, like, people who are devoting their lives to this research are saying that they're not sure that it will ever actually produce that end result, that promise. So, like, Dr. Furman said, I started out in a physics program, was working on kind of plasma physics in that direction, and I saw this happening, and it seemed, I mean, weird to me, right? Like, why does the government keep investing in this if there is so much uncertainty and this promise keeps failing to be fulfilled? So my research question for my master's project is basically, why has the United States federal government continued to significantly fund fusion research despite these decades of substantial but unkept promises? And kind of the way I've been framing it is, like, is this sort of promise of affordable, sustainable, clean, low-conflict energy sufficient to justify the support at any cost and over any time period? Or are these researchers, is this community just kind of selling their product well? And, I mean, obviously this sort of framing reduces it, and it's a lot more complex than that, but that's sort of the initial framing that I've been going with here. So the focus specifically that I've been looking at is the United States involvement with this particular reactor project. It's an international collaboration based in France. The International Thermonuclear Experimental Reactor, it's just shortened to ITER, and kind of looking at how the different groups involved with the policy for this are framing the research, what sort of narratives do they invoke when they're framing, when they're talking about and justifying this research. Are they sort of strategically making boundaries and making connections to certain other veins of research or differentiating themselves from certain veins of research? I thought that would be especially important in terms of the connection to nuclear weapons research. That can, I mean, depending on who your audience is, that's either a very big benefit or a very big detraction point, right? And then also kind of looking at where the opposition comes from. The United States was involved from the beginning with this project. It started with an agreement between Reagan and Gorbachev in the 80s, but then in the late 90s, the U.S. pulled out and then rejoined the project in the early 2000s. So where did that opposition come from? What sort of prompted that withdrawal? And then what justified the re-entry into the project? Like I said, just kind of an overview. It's a very large experimental reactor in France. Just to kind of give an idea of scale, this is a diagram of it. That blue figure right there is supposed to be a person. It's an international collaboration between the EU, China, India, Russia, Japan, Korea, and the US, which has also made it kind of complicated in terms of the international, getting the international politics there, right? Getting all of the governments to work together and, like, standardize everything and agree on how this should be done. So just kind of the methods, what I've been doing. Most of this work so far has been a discourse analysis, looking at the documents where the fusion research community justifies their work. So a lot of this has been sort of policy reports and advisory committee reports to Congress, particularly the Fusion Energy Science Advisory Committee, the FESIC. They're one of the most sort of active policy bodies involved with fusion research. This sort of domain is where I found some of the most interesting work on this. But I've also been looking at sort of other media, like public, like just journalism, press releases, budgets from different projects and labs, as well as peer-reviewed articles, which have been especially important in terms of sort of periodic milestones and the smaller goals. So just kind of First of all, just to give context, this research started out as a master's thesis. About halfway through, I realized that it was kind of too big to fit in the two-year master's thesis project paradigm, so I have moved it to a master's project, and I'm kind of setting it up now to move forward with this work in the context of my dissertation. So a lot of the results here are sort of preliminary and looking at directions to move forward with this, since there are kind of a lot of questions that have come up in doing this research. So far, though, I'm seeing sort of three main themes arising. There's this idea of sort of this periodicity and these milestones, which I had mentioned earlier, and I thought were going to be a very sort of central part to the justification process. These sort of stages of feasibility, this idea of first we have to demonstrate that this reactor design will actually produce fusion, like we can actually make fusion happen with this reactor design, then we need to make sure that it will happen on the scale that we need it to, and then we need to make sure that it will happen in a way that is like feasible and cost effective, right? So these sort of, these steps in proving that this is feasible and these steps that need to be kind of checked off before we can get to commercial energy. And this sort of, this framing of let's not worry about if is it economically feasible, let's just focus on these particular, the short-term steps. We need to make sure that we can make it happen with this reactor design before we even talk about is it economically feasible. This sort of framing has been used a lot in the policy reports to kind of not artificially extend, but to extend the time horizons for the project and make it seem more reasonable that the sort of end promise has not been acted upon or returned yet. There's this idea of sort of new regimes that I've seen pop up a lot in the policy reports especially. This sort of framing the research in terms of there's so much uncertainty and these are conditions that we've never dealt with before, and there are sort of unexpected instabilities and unexpected irregularities in the plasma that can't be modeled well and scaled up. So we can't use existing smaller reactors and use data from those to scale up to reactor scale because of all these instabilities and these new sort of unexpected conditions. We need to get to that sort of new regime, the higher plasma regime, the fusion regime, the like internal heating regime. They've got a bunch of different sort of ways that they frame this. But to get to that new area where fusion can happen and where the experiments will actually start to produce the results that they're promising, the reports argue that we need new materials, new sort of new equipment, new machines, new reactors, because the ones that we have right now don't scale appropriately, right? So there's this rhetoric of sort of these frontiers that, and it kind of ties into that milestone idea, right? That you've got these different things that need to be accomplished, and what we have right now isn't sufficient for that. So justifying a bigger machine, a newer machine, in terms of what it can accomplish that what we have now can't, and relying on the sort of specialized expertise of the fusion scientists. And then there's also been this idea of sort of needing a strategic balance. A lot of the time that's framed in terms of strategic balance between basic and applied research. A lot of the fusion energy research is sort of caught under this umbrella of fusion energy sciences, and then there's applied fusion energy research. And sort of this dichotomy between basic like materials and plasma science and the actual sort of mission-oriented, we are trying to produce an energy source from this research. And that sort of this framing of we need to balance both of these. We can't just focus on the basic research. We can't just focus on applied. We need to focus on balancing them so that we can get sort of spin-off and tangential like basic science, like new knowledge benefits on this sort of slow halting path to this final result. The policy reports especially have kind of been framing this research in terms of existing and sort of shared social narratives. And in the science and technology studies literature, there's an idea that kind of captures that. It was put forth by Jasnoff and Kim in 2009 this idea of what they call socio-technical imaginaries, which they've defined as collectively imagined forms of social life and social order that are sort of reflected in the designs and fulfillment of nation-specific scientific and or technological projects. So these kind of, it's a sort of formalized way of thinking about the these narratives that are invoked in this justification process that are sort of shared within a national context. And a lot of these I expected to see the sort of idea of energy security, energy independence, the ideas of sustainability and this connection to climate change, the sort of inherent politicalness of nuclear technologies, the sort of like atoms for peace, atoms for war idea, atoms for something, right? And those were kind of expected. I mean, this is a nuclear technology, this is, it's an energy technology, it's a low carbon technology. So it's very, those are kind of the obvious ones to employ. But there are also these two at the bottom that I, on some level expected, but was surprised at how they were used, I guess. This idea of social benefits coming from basic research, which is, it's an established, like, I mean, rhetoric, right? There's, basic research has been justified since the middle of last century in terms of, if we just let the scientists freely work on what they want, social benefit will eventually come from it. We can't predict how that'll work, so we should just let them lead their own work. And then this sort of idea of, U.S. leadership or sort of competitiveness, which I'll get to come back to in just a moment. And those last two kind of, they represent sort of tensions, right? There's a tension between basic and applied research, a tension between this desire for national leadership and this need for international collaboration. So Mike Fortune, another SDS scholar, has talked about this idea of sort of chiasma, this idea of sort of volatile tensions. When sort of in rhetoric, these two ideas that are normally seen as distinct or opposed are used together and become sort of indistinguishable and sort of co-productive and sort of contribute to each other, in his words. And I think that that is the what I'm kind of seeing here, and I think that that's sort of the theoretical frame that is going to be most productive for me looking at this these tensions that I'm seeing, especially between U.S. leadership competition and basic and applied research. And also, in sort of newer fusion projects, this sort of tension between private and public support. So like I said, this project kind of ended up being more than I expected and opening a lot more questions. And that sort of initial question that I started with, of like, are they just selling their product well, is not really, I think it's still an interesting question, but I think that a lot more sort of deeper and more sort of systematic questions have come up from this project that I want to look at in more detail going forward in my dissertation research. And looking forward for where to go with this. I'm kind of seeing like mainstream fusion energy research as kind of anomalous in this current neoliberalism context. Most of fusion energy research is not directly commercializable. And it's such a long time scale that there isn't really any sort of direct commercial value. And in a lot of ways, it and a lot of other big science projects, especially in physics right now, are kind of anomalous in that they don't fit into that sort of economics, profit-driven mindset that a lot of research funding during this period does. There's sort of moral imperatives around federal research funding, a lot of research funding goes into medical sort of things, into energy research, but then you've got these big science, especially big physics projects, like some like basic fusion research or the work happening at CERN where it's sort of particle physics that have no direct applicability or benefits to society, right? And they're still getting substantial amounts of funding. But I think the way that I'm framing this and think that I want to go forward with this that I am finding most interesting is sort of this, the way that big science itself is changing after the Cold War. So I think that I'm seeing fusion as kind of a case of this post-Cold War big science that I think is interesting. So since the Cold War, there's been this context of sort of increasing neoliberalization, increasing decentralization, and a very different sense of sort of national identity and national competitiveness without the sort of the USSR as this sort of, you know, blanket other to work against and to justify things against. And, I mean, the work that I've done has kind of gotten on questions of how is big science changing research practices and policy and discourse. But what I really want to look at moving forward is how is the changing context of big science post-Cold War changing research practices and policy and discourse? And what can that kind of tell us about how research funds are allocated, especially at a federal level, and how this sort of science, industry, government system interacts? And like I said, there's sort of comparative work that can be done with like Human Genome Project, National Nanotech Initiative, geoengineering, and so much of this does seem to kind of be based on like national narratives that I'm very interested in looking at how that sort of changes in different contexts, especially with international projects. So yeah, that's kind of what I've done so far, and where I'm thinking of going with it. Yeah, I guess if you have any questions, I don't know if you want to do those now or at the end. Thank you.
Will be opportunity to ask questions after both speakers go, right? But I don't know if it's customary to take questions now as well. I will wait. Okay. All right. Thanks again. Okay. So we're going to switch gears to a different student and a different topic, and then afterwards we'll have questions for both speakers. So now I'd like to introduce Stephanie GOLDSTEIN. Steph is currently a PhD student in clinical psychology. She's actually a student of mine, so I know her well. She originally attended Drexel as an undergraduate, actually, before coming to the PhD program. And she is interested generally in technology enhancements to health behavior change, and particularly in, as she'll explain today, a little what are sometimes called just-in-time adaptive interventions. She has a very strong career already through her graduate career. She's already published 14 peer-reviewed publications and has presented 56 conference papers. Actually, I think that those are 2015 numbers, so it's probably double by now. She's won a number of awards, including from NSF, from the Society of Behavioral Medicine, from PsyChi. And she is going to talk about... You changed your title slightly, so I better read. She's going to talk about a preliminary investigation of a personalized risk alert system for weight control lapses. So Steph, can I ask you to come up and give your talk, and then we'll have questions for both speakers.
Hi everyone. How does this work? Okay, cool. All right, well, I'm really glad to be here. This is exciting to see so many people out here interested in these two very, very different topics. But that's okay, hopefully they're both very interesting. So what I want to talk about today is partly my thesis work, but partly expanding on the work that both Evan and I have been doing together related to building a smartphone app that predicts lapses from a weight control diet. So to start off, given that everybody might not have a background of what weight control is, I guess I wanted to ask, you know, if anybody in this room has ever tried to form a new habit, like trying to wake up early or trying to, you know, get exercising or something along those lines, maybe trying to start a project earlier than the night before. I'm seeing some nods. So that's what it's like to form a new habit. And within, you know, this idea of behavioral weight loss treatment, that's exactly what we're trying to get people to do. We're trying to get people to form new habits surrounding their eating behavior so that it can make it easier for them to lose weight. And what we know works is we know that dieting works, right? So, and when I talk about dieting, I don't mean like crazy fad dieting that a lot of us hear about, but I more mean adhering to a basic calorie prescription that is manageable and doable over time, but also tips the calorie balance such that you're expending more energy than you're taking in. So that seems pretty simple, right? Simple, but not easy. So in behavioral weight loss treatments, we give people these calorie prescriptions, we give them nutritional information, we give them tips and tools and tricks, and if any of you have ever tried to lose weight before, you might have found that it's actually more difficult than that. It's absolutely not easy, though it seems simple. And what we find is that people either lose much less weight than it's expected, than they're expected to, or they regain most of their weight back within the year. So the short of it is that we have this good solution, but many people tend to fail. And the question that we sought out to sort of ask is why? And one of the things that we can look to is this idea of dietary lapses. So we can look at this at each eating decision is sort of like at a micro level, basically like a decision of whether or not you're going to stay on your prescribed diet. And when you deviate from that, we call those lapses. So those are micro instances of inadherence to a diet or like off-plan eating. So eating something that you hadn't intended. So for example, if like a brownie wasn't in your plan for that day, that would be considered a lapse. Or eating maybe when you hadn't planned, maybe you walked into Books and Bagels and you didn't plan to have a burrito for lunch, but maybe you did, and that's okay too. So those are these ideas of lapses. And we make dozens and dozens of eating decisions every day. So our likelihood when we're, you know, when you're in a weight loss program, the likelihood of lapsing is pretty good because, you know, at a certain level, you're making these decisions over and over and over again. And they're unfortunately problematic, right? Because they either can lead you to increase your caloric intake, which is not good for weight control, or they can feel frustrating and demoralizing and can sometimes lead people to just completely abandon their weight loss goals altogether. So in taking a closer look at this, for my thesis project, I, you know, summarized some of the literature on what is associated or what tends to predict dietary lapses. And there's a lot of different factors we've found. So what this slide does is it kind of summarizes different types of studies. So in the first row there, you have ecological momentary assessment studies. So these are the types of studies where we actually ask people to repeatedly track when they're lapsing from a diet, and then also track different factors that might have happened just before. So what we found is things like positive and negative mood and cravings tend to be associated with lapsing. Also things like exercising, socializing, watching TV are associated with those things. Those tend to be backed up with different other studies like weight loss studies or self-regulation studies. I won't go into too much detail. But essentially what this whole slide summarizes is this idea that there are many, many, many factors that can cause or lead an individual to lapse from their diet at any given moment in time. And many of these factors, if you're kind of looking at the theme here, are momentary in nature. Like they happen right here, right now. It's really hard to plan for them. And they kind of come up in a way that's almost unexpected. So, you know, you're not going to predict when you're going to be in a positive or negative mood. It sort of just comes up in that moment for the most part. So that's why we call them those momentary factors. And so and you'll notice that I categorize them as internal and external. So internal being like things that more go on inside you, and external being things that are going on in your environment. Right now, conventional intervention doesn't really address those momentary factors. We try to plan for it. So essentially, what we do in conventional behavioral weight loss is people come in once a week, and we talk to them about how their eating is going, and we give them generalized skills to sticking to their diet. We try to do some planning with them to see if they can avoid difficult situations. For the most part, everything's done in the clinic. And patients find it really difficult to translate those skills to real life. That's difficult for them to do. So in this respect, we thought, maybe there's a better way to reach people. Maybe we can give people something that they can have with them all the time, more often, to help them stick to their plans. And so that's why we thought that mobile intervention might be a good solution to this problem. So what we know from the literature is that lapses appear to be somewhat predictable. There's these sort of like core group of factors that are associated with lapses. We also know that if we're able to increase awareness of when a lapse is about to occur, we might actually be able to get people strategies to help them more in the moment that they need them. And smartphones are a great way to do that, because everybody's attached to their smartphones, right? I'm surprised actually more people aren't on their phones right now, which is really great. Thanks for being respectful, guys. but for the most part, everybody's attached to them. They're completely ubiquitous. Even people ages 65 and up, most of them have smartphones. Everybody's got them. They feel like an extension of ourselves. So we thought if we could get something on someone's phone that predicts when they're going to lapse from their diet and also gives them strategies in the moment that they need them, that would be a pretty powerful tool. There were a lot of steps between that idea and what I'm going to present now, but we're getting there. So the essential idea behind our theory was that if we could get someone on their phone to report things like when they're feeling positive or when they're feeling negative, when they're feeling tired or hungry, when they're feeling particularly motivated or unmotivated, or when they might be experiencing cravings, that we could take all of that information and use machine learning methods to see if we can use that information to predict when a user was at risk for lapsing. So machine learning methods are, I'm still sort of like learning what that is as a whole entire construct, because it's really, really big and there's so many possibilities. But essentially what we can do here is we can learn based on previously established behavior patterns when a user is going to be at risk for lapsing. And we can use different mathematical models to do that. And machine learning is kind of ideal for this problem because, this is an understatement on how many triggers you can include. I think in our models we included over 20. So you can include a lot of different triggers. Many of them don't have to have this like theoretical association or theoretical mapping. You can sort of just put them into the model and let the model actually decide what's the most predictive and what's going to be the most helpful for you, which is great because we don't have a good model of how all of these other factors fit together. There's so many of those. There's no way that we're going to be able to do that in a comprehensive way anyway. We can also make the predictive power better by combining your data with everyone else's data, so doing individual and population level learning. And then we can also weight predictive factors on things like BMI or race or gender or things like that. So in machine learning is quite complicated, but in the same sense, it sort of simplifies things because it can help us account for all these factors that under normal circumstances our current theoretical models wouldn't be able to do. So in that way, we decided to use it, and that was a large part of my thesis. So what I'll do today is I'll talk a little bit about what my thesis sought to accomplish, and then I'll talk about it in the context of our larger project of developing this app. So basically, my thesis sought to develop this type of algorithm. Can we actually make a model that predicts dietary lapses? And what we decided, this schematic just shows all the different steps that are usually employed to create a mathematical model of this nature. So essentially what we wanted to do is we wanted to use supervised learning, where that models the function of predictors based on a set of observations. So we wanted to collect this large database of lapses and predictive factors, and then use that database to build sort of like this base model. So in that sense, that's why they call it like supervised learning. So essentially we defined the task, which was predicting dietary lapses. We collected data, and I'll talk about how we did that in a second. And then we went through this process of training and testing. So essentially what we did is we put all the data into several different models, and we tried to tune the parameters and optimize things, and then we tested it and saw how it did. And then we did that process over and over and over again until we found a good set of models with appropriate parameters that we were confident in. And I'll share some of that data with you. And you can I'm only sharing a tidbit of it, so during the question section session of this, you can definitely feel free to ask me more questions. So this was the overall proposed study, basically some of the things that I just spoke about. Essentially what we did is we targeted overweight and obese adults because those are the individuals who are going to want to go on a weight loss diet and lapse from it. What we did is we prescribed them a pretty standard diet, which was the Weight Watchers diet. We actually got funding from the Obesity Society and Weight Watchers to conduct this project, so we sort of like have their support. What we liked about the Weight Watchers diet is it's, you know, it's been shown to be effective, but it's also very concrete. So if, for those of you who aren't familiar, users get assigned like a point value that they have to stick to, and every food that they eat gets assigned point values, and you sort of just like count the points until you're done for the day, and hopefully you don't go over. But essentially what we did is we actually gave people point targets throughout the day, and whenever they went over those point targets, that's what was a lapse. So we really, really closely operationalized what a lapse was for these people, because that was very, very important. There really shouldn't have been any ambiguity in that. And what we did is we put them on this diet and we continuously monitored lapses, and most of the triggers that you saw on that second slide through a smartphone app for 6 weeks. And we actually created our own smartphone app to do this called Diet Alert. And it basically prompted people 6 times a day, and they answered 8 questions a day regarding different things in their environment, different things that they were feeling, and then whether or not they had lapsed from their diet. This is a screenshot of our app. It's pretty simple right now, but we made it, so we're excited about it. And like I said, 6 random prompts throughout the day, 8 questions per prompt. We varied the questions throughout the day so that people wouldn't get sick of answering 20 questions 6 times a day, because that's a lot for people to do. So we ended up sort of taking that incomplete data set and doing a lot of different things with it. I can answer more questions about that towards the end, but it gets complicated, so I don't want to get into too much of all of the crazy data analysis stuff that we did. And then this is just an example of the Weight Watchers mobile app. So they were given this app so that they could track their points, and so that they could know whether or not they were lapsing from their diet. So it was really important that they were using this frequently, because you can't report a lapse if you don't know that it happened. So you need to be able to continue to track these things. And they also got things like support and helpful tools through Weight Watchers. So it was kind of really great, because Weight Watchers is more of like a self-help program. So it kind of mimicked the real world when you download an app and you're hoping that it's going to help you with weight loss. So we like that part of it too. So now I'm going to take you through some of what we found on the machine learning side and what we were able to accomplish. And then I'll talk a little bit about future directions, and then I'm going to probably want to be done talking soon. So this is a receiver operating characteristic curve for the model that we ultimately built. So essentially what we ended up doing is we ended up going with a set of ensemble classifiers, which are several different models that are sort of like mashed together to get the best outcome. So we used a set of Weka decision trees to do this, and we ended up getting pretty good results. So if you can see there, our accuracy was 72%, and our sensitivity was 70%, and our specificity was 72%. So accuracy is basically the total amount that the algorithm was able to predict correctly. The sensitivity is the amount of lapses that the algorithm was able to predict correctly, and the specificity was the number of not lapses. So essentially what these classification and decision trees do is they basically are trying to distinguish between lapses and non-lapses. So it's important to look at the accuracy, sensitivity, and specificity all sort of separately. They all have their own merit. In particular, we're very interested in sensitivity. Our goal was to get that as high as possible, because we really wanted to be able to predict lapse cases. That's what we truly, truly wanted. That was the most important thing to us practically. So what was really interesting about this project is that it really made us consider what was mathematically and statistically possible versus what was the practical implication of what we were doing, which continues to be, when I merge sort of statistics and psychology, it continues to be a thing that we come up against over and over and over again, of what's possible versus what the practical implications are. So that's just a sort of example of, it was a lot of work, so it feels like sad to just be like, that's my graph, but you know, it was really exciting results. To kind of give you guys an idea, in the literature this hasn't really been done before, so this would be the first time that anybody's modeled lapses from a diet, but when they do lapses for addictions, they get slightly higher results, but for the most part, like 70 and 80 is where we're at. I know that for more straightforward problems that aren't in the behavioral area, you would be looking for more like a point, like a 90 or a 95%, but for us, this is actually pretty good. So for those of you who are machine learning folks and looking at these numbers and wondering about them, that just gives puts them into context for you. Then we did a, we just tested for significance to see if the model was predicting significantly better than chance, and it was. So that was promising. And then what we did is, this is sort of a tidbit of some more interesting find, of one of, I think, our more interesting findings, is we actually tried to see how well this model generalized to the individuals. And what we found was, so we basically did a couple of different types of analysis, is we used this model to see if we could just predict any given individual's lapses with their own data. So we built every single person in the study, which was only 12, but it still took a lot of work. We built every single person's their own model and saw how well it predicted. So what you'll see here is the X's correspond to participants that we were able to achieve good model outcomes for. So a sensitivity that was above 70% and an accuracy that was better than chance. As you'll see here, which is surprising, is that for the individual models, those were actually, they didn't do as well. You would think that an individual's own data would help, would be the best thing for predicting future episodes, but that actually wasn't the case. And what we hypothesized there is because we didn't get enough lapse cases. People only lapse about 3 to 4 times a week. So if you're only collecting this over 6 weeks, we really didn't have enough to build a reliable model for every individual. However, by the same token, if you took any individual out and then tried to use the group model to predict their data, that also did not do very well. That was yielded no participant had adequate results for that. What was really interesting is when you combined the two. So when we actually added someone's data to the group and then tried to predict their next couple weeks of data, the model actually did quite well for most participants. So you'll see these X's over towards the towards your right side of the screen show that a little bit better. So our conclusions for that is that for this particular problem, because lapse instances are so rare, we really need to combine the power of both group and individual level data. And I'll talk about what the implications for that are in a second. Actually, I'll talk about that right now. So the essentially, what we concluded here is that we might need to either weight group and individual level and keep them both together, or we might start by not making any predictions at all within the app. So there's a bunch of different clinical applications for what this means, but essentially, we really do need both of those types of data to be successful moving forward. Okay, and so speaking of clinical implications, so for the future right now, we're actually taking this model and incorporating it into the current version of Diet Alert, and hopefully we'll be starting our pilot maybe within the next 2 to 3 weeks or so. So this will be a full system where participants will actually be able to report their triggers into the app and receive alerts to risk that are generated by the algorithm that I just showed you. And they'll actually get personalized interventions in the moment that they need them. So I gave you some screenshots here, but essentially this one on your most left is what it will look like. Users will get a notification that they're at risk, and then they'll actually get up to 3 interventions based on what factors put them at risk. So in that way, it's very personalized. The algorithm that we developed can actually tell what factors are causing people to potentially lapse. And then what we did is we developed a library of, I think, over like 150 interventions, and users will have access to that library, and they'll be given an intervention that corresponds to the factor that put them at risk. So sort of that gives it like a personalized feel, even though it's very methodical on our end. It gives users a personalized feel because they feel like, wow, the app is telling me that I'm hungry, and now it's giving me an intervention to help like cope with hunger in the future and help cope with hunger right now. So it feels like a person, we want it to feel like a personalized experience to them, because that's the whole point of having it be on your smartphone, right? Everything's supposed to be personalized to you. So we want the app to get to know you, and we want you to feel like you're being known by the app. And that's essentially it. I'm probably almost at my 5 minutes. So I will just acknowledge the people on my thesis committee and our programming team who are over in the, well, I guess sort of College of Business, College of Engineering, and then our funding sources. And yeah, I'm definitely open to any questions, and thanks for listening, everyone.
All right, well, so those were two terrific talks, and believe it or not, I actually got one of those risk alerts while Steph was giving her talk. Apparently mine says that I'm at medium risk right now of having a dietary lapse because of the time of day, and the app's going to help me break my bad habits by pattern smashing. So
it works.
So I figured I should, especially as Steph pointed out, although the obvious, which is that these are two very different talks, that the topics in a certain way could not be further apart, but I thought just to get this question, the question answer started, I should challenge myself to think about what they might have in common. And this is what occurred to me. Of course, I'm coming from a psychological, you know, framework, because that's what I do. But one of the commonalities I thought is that, in a sense, both of the talks got at this notion that human beings are not completely rational agents. We're not computers. We don't process information according to, you know, discrete logical rules, at least not entirely. And so from that premise, I thought maybe a few interesting questions might come out of that. And the kinds of things that I started thinking about are that, for those of you familiar with the idea of cognitive biases or other kinds of biases, even including the ways emotional and other kinds of unconscious processes guide human behavior and decision making, you know there's a wide area of research, both in, and even in the popular press, that points out this idea that we make decisions and we're guided by all sorts of things that don't really seem to correspond to what's in our best interests or what's purely logical. And so there have been studies and reports written about everything from how we interview graduate students to see if, you know, they should come to our labs, for example. The decisions we make, should we take someone, should we not take someone? Those are purely logical? There's a huge evidence base, for example, that the kind of thinking we do is biased towards interactions that have nothing to do with the question at hand. So we have all this paper record of somebody's accomplishments and talents and awards and so on, and then we essentially ignore all of that the minute we meet the person, and we're overridden by these very tiny factors that probably don't even matter. There's a huge literature base on that, for example. And presumably it's not in our best interest if we're the ones doing the interviewing. There's a similar base of research on dating decisions, on auditions for, you know, orchestras, that, you know, blind auditions produce very different results than non-blind auditions, et cetera, et cetera. So, and I think that's true. Those are kind of maybe, you could say, small to medium examples, but the wide range of human experience, that seems to be the case. And whether you're talking about, I think, an individual decision about like what to eat, what I thought Steph was pointing out was that we're not necessarily guided by what's in our best interest. Other things take over, like what we want in that moment, what tastes good, some idea about how long that it's going to take for that good feeling to last. You know, whether we're really ever going to suffer a disease or not. All these things we're supposedly thinking about, but not logically at all, presumably. And we don't do what's in our best interest for the most part when it comes to health decisions. And then maybe in humongous, you know, decisions that affect the entire human race, that apparently is true too. You know, the people who have the power to make gigantic decisions, who's spending millions, billions, maybe even trillions of dollars on scientific research, you would hope are guided purely by what's in the best interests of the human race or of the country, but apparently not so. So that was sort of one way that I thought the two talks are sort of unified, and I thought maybe a few questions might come out of that. I'll be interested to see what the speakers have to say. First of all, do you even agree that, like, do you even agree that this is a, that you know, both of those principles are operating for you, for your talk, the subjects of your talks. I was also interested in if you do, you know, to what extent can you, what's the remedy to our human failings, basically? What should we do about that? Because these are important decisions both for our own personal health as well as for the, maybe even for the whole human race, you know? And then this last one may be unfair, but I'll ask it anyway, but which is sort of like, do you have advice for each other? Either about your the study that you're involved in, or even just for the subject matter. Like, what would Steph, what would you do about, you know, what would you say to policymakers who have to make scientific decisions? Do you think there's psychological principles that you could speak to? And Derek, in reverse, you know, is there wisdom you've gained from thinking about this that you think apply to like a personal health decision? Or maybe even, or a system that someone could develop that would help us make better decisions about what we eat or things like that. So my three sets of questions essentially have to do with this notion, and I thought that would be an interesting way to get some questions answered, and then I know we'll take lots of questions from the audience. Either of you want to start? I can repeat the questions one at a time. Maybe come up, because I think people will pay the attention better.
First of all, I mean, it's the thing that came to my mind in terms of sort of people making decisions based on things other than like what's in their best interest is, at least in the case of what I've been studying, sort of the role of dependence on expertise in making those decisions. And I mean, I can see that fitting into the weight loss thing as well, right? You're depending on stuff, like medical experts and things like that, that like put together what interventions provides, right? So sort of that need to rely on someone else who knows more than you, kind of influencing the way that you make the decisions in terms of what you think is in your best interests, and then also kind of how we're defining best interests, right? Like who is deciding what best interest is and best interest for whom? Because like for the fusion research, that's a very, you know, contested thing. Like, I mean, very few people agree with the sort of best interests for society overall in terms of that end result of fusion energy. But the sort of milestones, I mean, it's a lot harder to make that argument. So I mean, that's not, you know, any sort of concrete answer, but sort of where am I going with that? Sort of the questions that would have to be answered to fully answer.
Short-term versus long-term.
just the sort of like investment in it already, but also the sort of the like, physical infrastructure too, right? And the sort of like behavior that you've got. But you can invest in it. I actually just this yesterday was visiting the plasma lab, the fusion lab at Princeton, and they have the remnants of one of the reactors that they put together. Or like it started to build and spent a couple $10 million on, and then the government pulled funding, so they just got like these giant pieces of reactors sitting in the room. So like it's interesting to see the ways that sort of that momentum and locking are handled. And you know,
you'll answer to that.
Yeah, I think if we had the answer.
Right, exactly.
But just to challenge you with one question related to this, if any of this is right, you know, what you're saying about that the human brains that are making all these decisions aren't making the best possible decisions, is there anything we can do about that from a policy perspective or from a technology perspective or from any perspective at all? What should we do? What's your advice to policymakers or psychologists or anyone who's grappling with these issues?
I think I'll let Derek take the policymakers one. I think for in the field of psychology and more like at the individual level, one of the things that helps, I mean, there are a couple things that help. I mean, one of the reasons why I like the utilization of technology is because it keeps the long-term benefits of your decisions with you on a more moment-to-moment basis. So if you're able to more think about, like, when you reach for that cookie, that, like, wow, this is going to make me angry and I'm going to be unhappy later, if you're able to keep that more at the forefront of your mind, then that's actually more helpful to you and hopefully making a better decision. So you're able to sort of tolerate that short-term discomfort because you know that you're in it for the long haul. And technology is a really great way to do that. And that's actually one of the mechanisms that we hypothesize these risk scores for actually help people do. So I think in that way, we always have to keep that trade-off sort of present with us. And sometimes just like being knowledgeable about that is helpful. Sometimes using other reminders or using your phone as a reminder, you know, training yourself on a day-to-day basis, every decision to be thinking about the long term. It's a lot of work. I wish I had a more shortcut strategy, but I think it's a matter of learning a new habit, learning a new behavior, learning a different way. And we need to start getting people more mindful of that. And whatever way we can do it, whether it's accessing them through theming, through technology, where people are more receptive to hearing these messages, I think that's the best avenue that I can, or one of the good avenues to go through. I won't say it's the best one or the only one for sure.
Yeah, so first of all, that kind of idea of making visible sort of background of assumptions and like factors, I think, is really important kind of across the board. And I think that sort of foregrounding of like assumptions and infrastructures is a big part of what the sort of participatory decision-making methods get at. One of the sort of like side directions that I've done with my research is actually kind of like, so if there is all this uncertainty in this research option, sort of, especially with these types of research options that have such substantial consequences, in the case of fusion, it's like a huge benefit, but a very uncertain, like great uncertainty of getting that benefit. There's also been some literature on like planetary defense with like asteroid impacts, huge catastrophic outcome, but very unlikely that it will happen. And I've done a little work on this in terms of looking at how, like, decision-making processes for dealing with that, and kind of like adapting different participatory decision-making paradigms for that. But a lot of it, I think, is down to that sort of bringing forward those background assumptions and those factors that you're not necessarily aware of that are influencing the decision-making process. And, I mean, being kind of honest and aware of it. Thinking through the different ways that they affect the decision-making process. And I mean, there, like I said, there are different ways that could be implemented, but I think that sort of is the crux of at least most, least bad way to answer that sort of question.
Yeah, okay. Fascinating, yeah. So let's see what questions the audience has. Yeah.
Thanks, guys. Great talks. I interact with Derek a lot, so I don't actually have any questions for him. Stephanie, I have a question for you, a general question. What is the scope of this personalized risk alert system you see in terms of what segments of the population are you, do you see this type of system you work before?
Well, for this particular system, we've built it to work for any individual who lives orally poorly. That being said, the algorithm is based on a small set of people. We did get mails and emails of different ethnicities, so we're hoping that that will be reflective, that that will be reflected in the model. So the scope is basically anyone who lives orally poorly. It's one we work for right now. Adults, not children. What we're most excited about, though, is the scalability of the approach that we use to develop. So right now we're actually working on developing another app for individuals with bulimia nervosa using almost the same exact type of system. And our programmers are doing a really great job of sort of making everything very interchangeable. And we're learning more and more and more about machine learning and how to do that as quickly as possible. Now that I've learned a lot more about it and our whole team is learning a lot more about it, so it's the process that we can actually continue to sort of replicate for lots of other health behaviors and so right now our app is overweight and obese adults who are on the lost diet. We're currently excited about more opportunities once we sort of get this system down.
There was a question in the back first.
Yeah.
STEM education stuff, but Amy Slayton in the history department here does a lot of that sort of education work. So it's definitely present in the literature that I want to and need to engage with more, but at this point, I'm not.
You had a question, right?
Yeah. Last question. Okay, my question is for you, Stephanie. There's 12 subjects currently, so I'm wondering, like, for your models, if you're saying that you could see like significant results at the individual level. So, like, do you have in mind the number of participants that you think you would need for you to get some more substantial, like, results? So, like, it could be more than one population. So when I see 12, I think, okay, actually, numbers are good, because sensitivity and specificity. But I would think that you need a bigger number to kind of get the
reports
worked out.
Yeah, I definitely agree. And my thesis committee and I went back and forth about that a lot. So we're definitely all on the same page. We're not sure how many people we would need. So we think it might be somewhere more like in the 20s range. Like if I could have collected like 10 to 12 more participants, we may see a model that's, you know, more generalizable. I think one of the things that has been most interesting about this work is that because of the nature of machine learning, the actual machine learning analysis sort of doesn't care how many people you have, it cares about the number of cases you have, so the number of lapse instances. And we had over 300 of those, so we were very, very well-powered to build a good model. However, that doesn't necessarily mean the model is generalizable, so there's a disconnect. And from, you know, my biostats professor, she's sort of like, oh, we have enough lapse cases, this is great, we can build an absolutely fine model. And from a psychological standpoint, we're like, well, what about generalizability? That doesn't quite map on. So we're actually really interested to test this with a group of people to sort of see, because the fact is we don't really know. My estimate and the recommendations from my committee would have been like about 20 to 25 to get a sample that's a little bit more generalizable for the population. But we'll have to stay tuned for what empirically the data shows.
Okay, so I don't see a clock, but are we out of time? Okay, so, well, first of all, join me in recognizing the great work of Stephanie and Derek and their talks. I guess thank you to the GSA and to the Graduate College and for hosting this event and organizing it. And thanks for having me as moderator. Yeah.
All right, so I just want you to join me thank the presenters and the moderator for today's presentation. And also thank you for being here till the end. I forgot to thank the IRT for live streaming this event. It's online, and I just saw that some people were following us online, watching. I just want to thank all of you for being here today. I just have something little to give to our moderator and presenters. You know, they need some marks to be drinking coffee as they continue to work their do their hard work. So I present this one to Dr. Foreman.
Yes.
All right. And Derek. All right. Thank you very much for coming. Yeah. And Stephanie. All right. So, yes, and I just want to thank you, and also I encourage you to attend our next event on May 13th. It will still be the same time here, and you have wonderful food, very, very good food, and always just to be come and help us have this conversation to encourage our colleague graduate students to continue their hard work as we want to make this university one of the best research universities. It starts from us, the graduate student, and we have to continue doing the good work that we are doing in our research and our field and to project the name of the school and ourselves. Thank you so much, and now we just have a photograph with the presenters and the moderator. So thank you for coming. God bless.
Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you.